As a female Jewish scientist, Lise Meitner fought through the scientific community to follow her passion for physics, even though she was barred from college until 1906. She fought through Berlin as an underpaid, underranked scientist. She fought to keep her life's work in an increasingly unsafe Nazi Germany. She fought through losing it all and getting betrayed by her partner when he claimed all the credit for her life's work to earn a Nobel Prize. Even after being exiled and losing everything she worked for, she still fought for understanding and the truth. Lise Meitner, originally Elise Meitner, was born in Leopoldstadt, Vienna, on November 7, 1878. She was born into a moderately Jewish family to Philip Meitner, a well-known lawyer, and Hedwig Meitner. She had six siblings, four sisters and two brothers. As a young girl, she loved math and science, and her parents supported every part of that interest. She went to school as long as the system would let her, in this case, until the age of 13. She waited until 1895, when Austria opened college to women. She got private tutoring to pass the exam to the University of Vienna. There she found a calling in physics with her enthusiastic teacher, Ludwig Boltzmann. She graduated in 1906, exhausted but proudly holding her doctorate in physics, only the second woman to do so. She then went to Berlin to start a career in physics at the KWI Institute of Chemistry. She started as an unpaid intern who worked with Max Planck, a highly respected scientist. After some time working with him, they hired her at the lowest ranking position, an unpaid honorary professor. She worked hard for a few years and finally got some pay. She started off very shy in Berlin, but over time slowly opened up. There was a very lively music scene among scientists in Berlin. This included Albert Einstein and her partner, Otto Hahn, who played the piano. Soon after she got there, World War I broke out and all of her colleagues rushed to join the military. Even her brother joined the war. They all thought the war would be short, but this was not the case. After almost a year of running a laboratory by herself, she felt a need to help in the war. She didn't want to work on any chemical weapons, so she helped the only way she could, as a nurse. More specifically, she worked as an x-ray technician near the front lines and saw many gruesome injuries. It did give her solace knowing that the x-ray could help people that were injured. At the end of the war, Germany lost and got heavily punished because of the Treaty of Versailles. This set the groundwork for World War II. After the war, Lise got promoted to professor, the first woman to get that position in Germany, and maybe all of Prussia. Lise settled down and started to work on her project of finding the mother substance of the element actinium. While she was in the lab, Germany's economy was in shambles. There was little food and inflation was starting to get out of hand. In 1918, it was not so bad, but started to get worse. Yet Lise did not care about the state of Germany. She only cared about physics. Lise worked long hours tending to the lab, even when her partner was gone. She focused mainly on the rays of radiation, which made a rival of a fellow scientist, Werner Heisenberg. They often quarreled over whether rays were continuous or discrete. By 1923, the economy was crumbling, and Lise was struggling to get by. All of Germany was, too. The price of bread was almost 200 million marks. All of her colleagues were demanding their paychecks before the worth of the money went down. This caused outrage among the people against the government and finally led to a coup d'etat, which set the stage for the future tyrant leader of Germany, Adolf Hitler. But Lise was back in her lab. According to her letters, she didn't even know about Hitler yet, as she didn't pay attention to politics. She had found the mother substance of actinium, and it was named proactinium. She published her work, but published it as Otto Hahn's work, as she didn't think much of herself. This got some recognition from the scientific community, but not really to her, so she was still unknown. At this point, things in Germany had reached a breaking point, and Hitler was named Chancellor of Germany to appease the people. Hitler immediately started making laws and expanding his power. In 1925, Germany's president died in mysterious circumstances, and Hitler went into power. He implemented a fascist regime and started taking control of every aspect of German life. Meanwhile, Lise Meitner was working on her most famous experiment, nuclear fission. She did not just research it, she invented it. She wasn't trying to invent it, she was just researching the chemical reactions involving nuclear elements. She, along with Otto Hahn and Fritz Straussmann, helped to invent nuclear fission, winning a Nobel Prize for only one of them, but we'll get to that part later. This project took a while, and in the meantime, Hitler was rallying Germany. By 1932, there were brown shirts in the streets and Nazi flags everywhere. There was severe anti-Semitism by 1932, and in 1933, there was the book burning, where they burned many books written by Jewish authors, including some of her colleagues and even some of Albert Einstein's books. Eventually, Hitler told the institutions to start laying off non-Aryan workers, and Lise's teaching permit got revoked. Still, she was not yet concerned about her research position. Jewish lawyers and store owners were losing their jobs, and people were considered treasonous if they did not greet each other with Hail Hitler. Many great minds of the scientific community, including Albert Einstein, were kicked out, as 20% of the science positions and 30% of physics positions were held by Jews. In 1935, Lise was laid off from her position. Her academy and Otto Hahn managed to convince the Nazis that she was useful, which kept her job until then, but it was clear she needed to leave, and soon. It may have been clear to everyone else, but Lise was reluctant to leave, as it took her so long to get to this point. She didn't want to leave her life's work behind, so she stayed. She got bullied, hated, and her lab space shrunk, but she stayed. In 1937, it was starting to get dangerous, so she started looking for other jobs. The problem was that no one wanted to take in Jewish refugees, especially in job positions. They just didn't want to deal with extra problems on top of their own. There was a job at a new institute in Sweden that could give her lab space but not much pay. She made arrangements and coded letters as mail was regulated. At last, she was ready, but there was one problem, her passport. As Austria had been absorbed into Germany, her passport was no longer valid. Her friends appealed to the government, a last-ditch effort, but it was clear the government did not want her to go. Tensions were extreme in Germany by 1938, and Lise and her friends knew she had to get out. They made plans, and on a cold night in November, Lise said farewell to her colleagues, and Otto Hahn gave her his mother's ring for money. One of her colleagues drove her to a train, and she left without complications, leaving her life and her science behind. She got to Sweden, and as expected, there wasn't much there, but she still had a lab, and spent the rest of her life exiled there, alone, at 60 years old. In 1944, Otto Hahn won the Nobel Prize for his work on nuclear fission. Lise was absent from his speech, even though she did the majority of the work. All of her career was overshadowed by a stolen award. Lise was happy for Otto, but at that point, she felt as though she should have been co-awarded the prize. In later years, she got the recognition that she deserved, getting invited to lunch with the U.S. President and winning multiple awards, including the Otto Hahn Award. She was even invited to work on the Manhattan Project, but she said, "I will have nothing to do with a bomb," yet she is still known as the mother of the atomic bomb. When she passed away, her nephew, Otto Frisch, wrote this on her grave, "The scientist that never lost her morality." Her greatest honor, though, was given to her after her passing when Element 109 was named Meitnerium in her honor in her life's work. Now she had something even Otto Hahn did not. Lise Meitner was a fighter. She fought through life headstrong, pursuing science. She may have not gotten the recognition she deserved, but she wouldn't have wanted that to define her. She would have wanted her passion to define her. She was a great person, but an even greater scientist.